This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, the Mississippi River crests in Memphis, and Booker T. Washington High School will be getting a visit from the president. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, and Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer.
Welcome to Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Thanks for joining us. Our first topic today is, of course, the flooding up and down the Mississippi and the tributaries. Garnered a lot of local news, obviously, a lot of national news, maybe a little too much national news, which we'll get to at some point. But without a doubt, it was historic. The river has crested with maybe less damage than feared, but still a lot of impact. We're going to start with photos from NASA. The first photo is a photo from April 2010, basically a year ago, showing the rivers at a normal stage, the Mississippi there and some of the tributaries. And then we'll fade to a recent photo that's maybe a week old that shows the river 3 miles across. You see some of the flooding in the north up near that 40 sign, and just an incredible sight that all of us witnessed over the past week or so. Bill, let's start with you and just talk through some of the things that were that have happened in the last week and where what happens next.
Well, the river crested on Tuesday, probably early Tuesday morning. The precise measurement we probably won't know for about a week. That's a measurement that'll go in the record books. But it looks like it's going to be maybe a few inches under the predicted crest of 48 feet. The record, the all-time record is 1937, 48.7 feet. So this is the second highest record high for the Mississippi River at Memphis since they began measuring the river. As you said, 3 miles wide. Basically, the river in normal times is about a half mile wide at Memphis. It's gone 3 miles wide, which is basically everything between the bluffs in Memphis, and actually part of the bluffs in Memphis, and the mainline levee over in West Memphis, Arkansas. The effect, if you're downtown, is water from the riverfront about as far as the eye can see. Just some other numbers, we're talking about 16 to 18% of the total land area of Shelby County that flooded in one way or another. Probably about 500 to 600 people in five shelters across the county as we speak on this.
Most of that was in North Memphis, in the Woodstock, Cuba neighborhood. Is that correct?
Right. North Memphis, North Shelby County into Shelby Forest. Millington, unfortunately, which has plenty of experience with flooding, has been really dealing with this crisis anew with this. Some parts of South Memphis. But the main problem has been the five tributaries in Shelby County that feed into the Mississippi River, because the water from those rivers could not, you know, stream out into the Mississippi River because the Mississippi was so high.
To some extent, we were lucky over the last week that all that rain we had some weeks ago, we didn't have much rain. And that was, I know, a real concern that those tributaries with nowhere for that water to run off, any sizable amount of rain would cause real trouble. I guess that's still a problem or still a concern that the river's still high. It just happens to have crested and it's going to slowly come down.
It's a concern, but it's not a major concern because we just got pounded with about two periods of torrential rain right before things stopped and cleared up. You know, what's going to happen is this water is going to be at around between 40 and 47 feet probably through the end of the month. The crest will come down gradually a few inches a day. If you look at just last week, the river was rising at a foot a day.
And to some extent, and we'll talk more about the national coverage, but some of what the message from government, from political leaders has been locally is, look, it's okay. This is, we have this under control. The whole city is not underwater. Mayor Wharton has been on virtually every national news show, it seems possible, and his message has been, and I think we would repeat that message, is, you know, the city is up, open, functioning, open for business. There are some areas flooded, but it's a small number of people and a small number of land area. Some of the areas around here, though, have been affected really terribly. And let's start maybe less with the Tunica area.
Tunica area, certainly with the casino situation down there. They had a staggered closing that began on April the 28th and went through May the 2nd, I believe, was the last one to close. You've seen some of the aerial footage, no doubt, during the week. Those places like Hera got hit very hard. Fitzgerald's got hit very hard. And we're talking in terms of the millions of dollars basically there in Tunica. And we'll get back to that one, but I also want to say, I want to talk about the area, another area that was hard hit was the Tunica cutoff area right by the Mississippi. 500 people evacuated from there. There's probably going to be nothing left when they get ready to come back. But certainly, speaking of coming back, we'll go back to the casinos where, Bill, millions, 10 million an estimate a month as long as the casinos stay closed, 10 million lost to the state of Mississippi.
Right. It's really interesting because, as everybody knows, Tunica has a riverboat casino, so the casinos themselves actually float. The problem is the parking lots don't. Yeah. And if you don't have parking lots, you don't have customers for this. The casinos, from what we heard in Tunica, are paying the employees while they're off. Now, if this is a sustained period of high water, who knows if that will continue. But the casino industry in Mississippi is taking a big hit. Those communities there, which rely on two things, primarily casino gaming and agriculture, are taking a big hit. And in the case of the Tunica cutoff development, that's one of those areas where the land use officials are going to have to make some decisions about whether they allow rebuilding. There.
Is that a newer development or a long-time development? I'm not familiar with Tunica cutoff.
No, it's been there a while.
It's been there for quite a while. Okay. But it's one of those areas like we had with the trailer parks in North Shelby County and Fraser. They've been there for quite a while, too, and they always flood. I mean, some of these areas, not much of an exaggeration to say if someone leaves the garden hose on, they start to flood. So how many, you know, the question in this flood recovery effort is going to be, How many times do you rebuild some of these places?
Jackson. You know, a couple of footnotes to what Les and Bill have said. The casinos are actually lucky. They have had this damage, and the hotels in particular have been damaged. Mm-hmm. But the actual riverboat casinos, they're actually lucky because what was a legislative dodge when casino legislation was passed in Mississippi, that they had to be actual boats on the river, that's actually enabled them to survive for later on. Mm-hmm. Bill, you mentioned Eric, you did the tides, which way the tides were going. Actually, as it was pointed out during a recent tour of congressional people of the flood areas, it's a west to east and an east to west kind of situation where you've got two different kinds of tides kind of mingling with each other. That's part of the problem. But anyway, this has attracted the eyes of our congressional representative. Senator Alexander was here last Friday, along with Congressman Marsha Blackburn, Cohen, and Stephen Fincher. And they had a pretty good look at the situation. They had a very good briefing at the Emergency Operations Center on Avery. And that was kind of eerie because as the various people, Bob Nations and other people, were talking about the situation, you had this huge wall on which live images, helicopter images of the flooded areas were showing. And you could see certain things, for example, like President's Island looked a lot more in danger there with all that water around industrial silos and so forth than it may be. In fact, Nations had a new euphemism for the situation. They were islandized. So those facilities were islandized.
Right. You mentioned the congressional delegation. Steve Cohen, congressman from Memphis, spoke on the House floor this week, going back to that message of, yes, it's been a problem, but it's not as bad as it seems. Let's go to that tape that we have from Representative Steve
Cohen. But the fact is the city of Memphis is open and open for business, and most of the city of Memphis is not affected by the flood. Contrary to what you might see on the news, the entire city is not underwater.
And again, that message was, you know, going on and on. And it's a funny balance for political leaders to not be insensitive to the people who've been moved out of their homes or the people whose property's been damaged. I mean, really rough stuff, but again, nowhere near maybe the severity that we feared and the severity that in some ways was projected in some of the national media.
I don't want to forget our friends in eastern Arkansas, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
They also suffered towns like Devals Bluff, Bisco, some of those places in there completely flooded, completely isolated in some cases, where the necessities of life, food, water, are becoming a critical thing. So I know Governor Beebe is like all the rest of these governors, putting in for federal aid and hoping they're going to get it. But yeah, they were also hit, not to mention, of course, that I-40 situation that happened, where there was a detour of 120 miles between when you got to Brinkley, Arkansas, because the westbound lanes had flooded. So
I had friends coming to the Grizzlies game last weekend, and they had flown from Little Rock. I mean, they normally just drive over. It's not that long a drive. And, you know, they got a charter flight at the last minute to get to the game.
Yeah.
Some of the other things that have been kind of regional part of the disaster, that the federal aid is going to come in. Maybe you can touch on that bill. It's been declared a disaster area, so federal money will start flowing in at some point.
The interesting thing is we actually have a backup of storm damage and flood declarations that go back to about April 4th, and the first of those declarations was actually made by the White House, so the money's beginning to come in. And the story of how this recovery effort came off here in Shelby County is going to be a big backstory for all of this.
All right. Well, we'll touch on this next week as things, again, begin to hopefully recede. You mentioned the White House, and this week there was huge news for Memphis, and specifically Booker T. Washington High School, which won basically a competition to have President Obama come and speak at their commencement this coming week. Let's start with you, Les, and your thoughts on this big achievement for the school.
Huge achievement for a school of great historical stature. A great inner city school. It's produced people like Willie Harrington, along with Ben Hooks, Fred Jones of the Southern Heritage Classic, Willie Gregory, and Memphis CEO here for Nike. I mean, a ton of people have come out of Booker T. Washington. The inner city school where 70% these days of the households are single parent families, usually a mother, not so much a father. They around one of the most notorious projects that is now being renovated, the Claiborne Homes area there. 84% of these kids graduate. And it's remarkable when you think about the poverty that has surrounded them, but yet they have persevered. And for the president to pick us, and I say us, I mean, it's our town and our school, and we should embrace it. Out of the six finalists, or the six who were chosen to do this in this race to the top video thing presentation, it's just a marvelous thing. I mean, words can't express for us how much it means. And on the other hand, for the president, I think it also means something, because this is exactly what he talks about, is this whole raising up of the educational level. And when you've got circumstances, the type of circumstances of inner city schools like this reaching to the top and striving to be, I mean, it fits right in.
It's also an interesting point of view when you talk about school consolidation, the fight between the suburban schools and the city schools. And you look at this young, energetic principal who's in the video.
Yes.
If you go to the YouTube Booker T. Washington White House, you can see it. And she speaks about, you know, them having to raise the standards, get, you know, hold these kids to accountable. All these things that all good educators do, be it a suburban school or an inner city school. And I thought that was an interesting perspective.
Yes.
We also have, and then I'll let you talk, Bill.
Okay.
We have some video of Obama did this last year, a school, Kalamazoo Central High School. We have a little bit of video from that that we'll just put on the screen when he spoke to a school up in Michigan. But go ahead, Bill.
I was just going to say, this is a real forum for President Obama to talk more specifically about education reform. His administration has been involved very extensively with the whole statewide reform debate here, lobbying legislators in Nashville to lift the charter school cap in 2010. So it'll be interesting to hear what the president has to say during the stop in Memphis on Monday.
And I don't want to take away from it at all, but earlier this week he met with the Black Caucus. He hadn't met with the Black Caucus, Congressional Black Caucus, since his election. And they gave him a little tongue-lashing about minority jobs. They think he should be doing more and that type of thing, and maybe he's ignored minority needs. So it fits there with that.
And somebody else is profiting from this is Crowner Cash, who is attaching very much to the publicity as an example of what he has achieved while this school merger thing is going on.
All right, we'll leave it there and move on to city-county budget issues. We'll start with the city, Amos. Budget season is in full force. Some heated back and forth among the mayor and the city council. I foolishly said a few weeks ago on this show that it seemed like it was a quiet budget season. I was proved wrong, and I will admit that. Tell us where we are with the city budget first and what's going on.
Mayor Wharton has presented a $670 million budget, which funds city operations for the next fiscal year, which begins July 1. To produce a balanced budget, he had to come up with several one-time revenue measures. Produces about $60 million to fill a $60 million gap that we had. That money won't be there next year, okay? So we'd be looking at another $60 million deficit next year. Council members, they're really even divided. It's a 12-member council now. Barbara Swearingen Ware was indicted on a felony count, and she was suspended, so you're down to 12 members. So you got to get 7 of the 12 members to agree on a budget. And really, there's been no agreement. I mean, roughly half the council, they really think we need to tackle this now. We need to make stiffer cuts to the city budget and include layoffs. You know, we need to do more to balance the budget without these one-time revenue-generating measures. You have other council members, I guess most notably Janice Fully Love and Joe Brown, who say they're opposed to layoffs and they're also opposed to a tax hike. Well, you can't have both. And at the last city council meeting, council members are basically kicking the Wharton administration in the teeth over these layoffs while not proposing anything of their own. Joe Brown even said, I hope the administration comes up with something. Well, that prompted Mayor Wharton to come down to city council very, very upset. You never see him.
He's a pretty cool customer in terms of his presentation.
That's right.
Publicly.
But he got... You know, he got really sick and tired of hearing these council members criticize proposed layoffs and other budget measures without offering any ideas of their own. So he came down to city council and he essentially said, look, I'm not going to lie to people. We're in a big mess, and we're going to have layoffs. We're going to have other measures to balance this budget. And he's basically begged council members to come forward with their own proposals, but that hadn't happened yet.
All right. And then we're going to touch real briefly, just 30 seconds, on the county budget and where that stands with Mark Luttrell.
They're also, the county commission is heading toward a June vote on the budget, just like the council is, or a continuation budget. The Luttrell administration got a big break this past week because the Med said that essentially the hospital will forego the $10 million in emergency funding it got last fiscal year. That's a little bit less than half of the $22.7 million in red ink that is in the county operating budget proposal. So both bodies moving forward, the same basic debate. Do you do what you need to do to get into this budget year, or do you make some long-term reforms in spending?
All right, well, we'll keep up with the budget as it goes along. We're going to talk about the schools. We mentioned schools before. This is the ongoing school merger case that's before federal judge Hardy Mays. Update us on what happened this week, and then we'll talk about some things that happened in the legislature this week.
This is the first hearing where Judge Hardy Mays has begun deciding some of the parts of the case. He heard oral arguments this week, at the end of this week, on the various state laws that are involved, the legality of them, how they work, basically. That's what he's been called on to decide first. And he's also going to decide about an injunction that would bar the county commission from appointing a countywide school board. These are the first hearings after three rounds of attempted mediation. He began the hearing Thursday morning and said, basically, I guess I'm going to have to decide this. So he began hearing arguments that the issue has been probably overly briefed by the attorneys in terms of their written statements. So while he let them make oral statements, he didn't let them just go off on a tangent. He peppered them with questions for most of the day.
And he continues, at least in my mind, to be the star of the show. He has the greatest quotes, the greatest comments. There's a quote in your story, and I'll only paraphrase it because I don't have it in front of me, that, you know, to one of the lawyers, thank you very much, but if you would answer the question I ask next time, not the question in your mind, that would be helpful. Right. Les, some thoughts on Hardy Mays.
I think the guy, you know, we were talking about back in the dressing room about how fate does things. He was the last judge there when... for the day when this the first of these lawsuits starts coming in. So it falls in his plate. And as fate would have it, he seems to be the best guy to deal with this. He's got that sense of humor, but yet he's also mobilized, and he's trying to narrow down all these different shreds of what he's got to take in on this whole thing. And I don't think there could have been a better guy.
He's conducting a very muscular Socratic inquiry. He reduced most of those arguments to speechlessness as he found their contradictions. And he's hard on himself. At one point he said, well, I must have been wool gathering. I missed that point.
Let's do real quickly. We've got 30 seconds to talk about the collective bargaining situation in the legislature.
Well, because Beth Harwell, the Republican House Speaker, had to keep faith with her party mates. She broke a tie in the House that allowed a House version of the bill that deals with collective bargaining for teachers to go to the floor. It'll go to the floor Monday, and it will be voted on there. A harsher Senate version has already passed that absolutely abolishes collective bargaining for teachers.
Statewide, this is not just Memphis, this is statewide.
Statewide, and the House version allows a modicum of collective bargaining, but that version will probably be passed in the House, but when you get into the reconciliation process, there's no telling which version will predominate. But Ron Ramsey in the Senate is determined to get that hard version through.
It's pretty amazing. And then again, all these reforms race to the top. It will make Memphis, specifically Tennessee broadly, I mean, a hotbed of change and experimentation, to put it as neutral a term as possible, on education in Tennessee.
And I should say that John Stewart on The Daily Show had a good time this week talking about two bills that have really been passed by one House and are killed in the other. That's the Don't Say Gay bill and the evolution bill. So a lot of the controversial things have passed, but Stewart had a good time with it.
Yeah, and you mentioned John Stewart. We go to our last story, which is back to the floods, and in this case, the national media's coverage of the floods. We're going to start with John Stewart and his comment on the media this week in Memphis. That was, I think, an experience a lot of us had, not just in media, but, local media did, I think, a really good job covering this.
Yeah, I think we did.
Keep people informed. The national media was, it was surreal, it was absurd. It was, I lobbied our producer, Pierre, that we should all do the show in hip waders today and be here in boots. Bill did bring his boots,
and I thought that
was fantastic and certainly necessary, because the floodwaters are only 20 miles from us right now.
Right.
It was crazy. I mean, there was also one more comment. I was half watching the show, the CNN in Nashville this week in my hotel room. I look, and there's a guy in hip waders down at Harbortown, where I had been the day before, where I know there were people at Paulette's, at Tug's, drinking wine, looking at this guy out in the water in his hip waders. It was crazy. Go ahead,
when the congressional tour got to the pyramid last week, there clearly was no overt flooding happening. There was a lot of building of wall and sandbags and so forth. Congressman Cohen made a joke. Where are those boats that Bass Pro ought to be putting here?
Right. Other stuff. I mean, I saw Al Roker on the Weather Channel. I guess when you're in a hotel room, you always have the Weather Channel on. I look over there and I realize not only was he in waders in the Mississippi, I swear they'd done something with the camera to make it darker, because it was midday and it was this foreboding sense. And Al Roker spent something like 2 hours broadcasting from the river.
A lot of us, I think, got calls from various media outlets to do interviews about this. And I had one pretty memorable one. I won't name the radio station. It's not one here in Memphis, it's somewhere else, but you're waiting to go on, and I hear this intro that says, imagine if a wall of water was heading toward your city. That's what's happening in Memphis this morning. How do you start off an interview by saying, no, that's not what's happening.
And that last image we saw in that montage a while ago, the guy up to his nipple, that was a pun.
Right.
There were no structures in that shot.
It was just brutal coverage. TV, relies on
the image.
Hey,
watch out.
But they have
national
TV. They have to have the visual, and it's absurd. It reminds me, a few years ago, there's flooding in the Northwest, and I saw a Today Show reporter. She was in a canoe in the street, and she's doing her interview from a canoe, and all of a sudden, two guys carrying their groceries walk right behind her. The water was this, it was up over their ankles, and this woman's in a canoe.
All right, let me take it up for my television brethren here, okay?
All right, it's all on you.
Here's the deal. It is May. It is sweeps period for those of you that don't understand. And sweeps period, the last and final one before November. So everybody is looking for the big, big story to get big, big ratings. That's how it happens. We hope to get ratings on this show, don't we?
Yes.
Yeah, we get big, big ratings.
So, that's why I wanted to wear hip waders.
Yeah, you wanted to wear
the hip waders. That's why I brought the boots.
The other thing was that it hit the news cycle. Osama bin Laden's death had pretty much worn itself out. The wedding in England, that had worn itself out. And this was so staged to the point where, okay, there's a river cresting. We all know this now. It's going to crest on this day. And whatever. So news organizations were going, okay, we can go there. Right. We can see more human tragedy.
And Memphis, what was the big city? It was easily explainable. The way I told one radio station was, look, the night that the river was approaching the crest, you do realize that while Riverside and Beale was flooded, less than a mile away, there was a sellout NBA playoff game going on in FedEx Forum.
And I was there. I said the same thing to my family. Thank you all for joining us. Good night. Go to WKNO.org for more information about the show. Thank you.